Those are the issues.
Let's talk about the Democratic race as it stands today. Right now we have a front runner, a challenger, and an influencer. Hillary Clinton is the name that the most people are familiar with because she's been in the national spotlight for decades. She's been first lady, a senator, a presidential front runner in 2008, and secretary of state. Not to mention that, like, she is a she. It's shameful that a woman has never been president in the U.S., and many voters are eager to rectify the situation. Like, all else being equal, why not vote for the candidate in a pantsuit with a stacked resume? If every primary and caucus were held today, Hillary Clinton would be the nominee easily. But her challenger, Bernie Sanders, and his supporters are working overtime to broadcast that all else is not equal. The Clinton brand is notoriously centrist. In part one of this series on the 2016 election, I briefly outline how and why, in my opinion, Bill Clinton's presidency leaned center-right. So Bernie Sanders finds himself with plenty of room to run to the left of Hillary. I mean, they're both progressives, but like, where Hillary wants to improve on Obamacare, Bernie wants Medicare for all. Where Hillary wants college tuition to be cheaper, Bernie wants public colleges to be free. Where Hillary wants to overturn Citizens United, Bernie actively refuses to participate in the style of politics that Supreme Court decision has enabled. Most importantly, though, Bernie is so on message that it's borderline irritating, right? Income inequality. The rich have gotten richer, the poor have gotten poorer. Our entire political system has been sold out to millionaires and billionaires, and we need a revolution to stop it. And finally, we have Martin O'Malley, who on paper it looks like there should be room for in this race. He's the only governor of the bunch, and he got a lot done while he was in office. But in every poll that matters, O'Malley places a distant third. Like, barring some act of God or implosion of another candidate, he will not be the nominee. But my hunch is that 45th president of the United States isn't the office he's really after in the first place. This race has raised Martin O'Malley's profile to the point that a run in 2020 or 2024 might bear more fruit, or a well-timed endorsement of the eventual nominee and winner could score him a cabinet position or even the vice presidency. So those are the candidates. That's the relatively easy part to wrap your brain around. The specific logistics of the nominating process, though, this is where things get a little more complicated. Clinton, Sanders, and O'Malley are each competing for the lion's share of the Democratic Party's 3,636 pledged delegates. The delegates are divided amongst the states roughly proportionately based on state population, and each state's delegates are assigned to a particular candidate proportionately based on how the state votes. Now, each state has slightly different rules as to how voting works, but for example, the first state to vote in 41 days will be Iowa, where they have a kind of unique caucus system. Primaries are basically a traditional election. Polls are open all day, you show up when you want, vote for your candidate, and then leave. Caucuses, though, are more involved. Voters are given a designated time to show up at their precinct, and then are allowed a period of time to talk amongst themselves, trying to win over undecided voters to come and, you know, support your preferred candidate. Once that's done, caucus-goers literally stand in different corners of the room assigned to each particular candidate, and they tally up the percentage of support for, you know, Sanders, Clinton, and O'Malley. If, for example, Bernie Sanders gets 50% of the vote in the Iowa caucuses on February 1st, then 23 of the state's 46 delegates will be pledged to vote for him at the Democratic National Convention. Making things even more complicated, on top of the 3,636 pledged delegates, there are also 704 superdelegates who are Democratic members of Congress, Democratic governors, just generic bigwigs in the party, who are allowed to vote for whoever they want at the Democratic National Convention. And they bring the grand total of delegates to 4,340. In short, to win the Democratic nomination for President of the United States, a candidate must win a majority, at least 2,171 delegate votes at the Democratic National Convention. You may be wondering, why then are the first two states to vote, Iowa and New Hampshire, considered so important when they're only worth 46 and 24 pledged delegates, respectively, on the long road to over 2,000? I think the idea here is that voters from later states will be influenced by the results of early contests, and allowing relatively small states to go first means that relatively small campaigns have a chance to get a foothold. Barack Obama would not be president right now if he hadn't won the 2008 Iowa caucuses. If, say, every state voted at the same time, his grassroots campaign wouldn't have had time to, you know, take root and grow, right? The Clinton machine would have won by default. The same is true this cycle. If Clinton wins Iowa and New Hampshire, she will be the nominee. It's game over. But if we look at current polling, we see Clinton with a sizable lead in Iowa, but trailing Bernie Sanders in New Hampshire. If I'm the Sanders campaign right now, the game plan looks something like, you know, keep it close in Iowa. You don't have to win, but outperform expectations, and then win decisively in New Hampshire. And hopefully that will change the media narrative from Clinton's inevitability to the collapse of Clinton, question mark? From there, it's still not easy by any stretch, but it opens the door for a dogfight that might last well into the spring. Conversely, if I'm the Clinton campaign, I'm thinking, Iowa, Iowa, Iowa. Win there, use that as a springboard into narrowing the margin in New Hampshire, and close the door on Bernie Sanders before the race even begins. I mean, he might stick around until Super Tuesday, but would need a miracle to stay in the race past March 2nd. What do you think the Democratic race is going to look like? Leave a comment below or upload a video response and email a link to danbrownuniverse@gmail.com for a chance to be featured in a subsequent political Pokobat video. Happy holidays also. I'm going to be checking out for a little bit here, going back to Nebraska to see my family, but we'll be back in the swing of things in early 2016. I'll see you next year. Hey world, I'm Dan Brown. We are 321 days away from the 2016 U.S. presidential election, and on Saturday night, the leading Democrats got together for a spirited debate.
The rhetoric coming from the Republicans, particularly Donald Trump, is sending a message to Muslims here in the United States and literally around the world that there is a clash of civilizations.
When ISIL does training videos that say the easiest way to get a combat assault weapon in the United States of America is at a gun show, then we should all be waking up.
When we have massive income and wealth inequality, when we're the only major country on earth not guaranteeing health care to all people, all of the issues that the governor talked about, the secretary talked about, those